Het is 5:30 in de morgen. Duizenden monniken en nonnen zijn hier uit omringde landen voor 10 dagen neergestreken. Vanuit dit tijdelijke verblijfsoord begeven ze zich elke morgen naar het centrum van Bodh Gaya, een plaatsje in het noorden van India. Hoewel het vochtiger is dan normaal in deze tijd van het jaar, is de lucht er rokerig en stoffig. Geen wonder in zo'n kleine provincie waar 70 miljoen mensen wonen.
Bodh Gaya is considered for Buddhists perhaps one of the holiest places, because this is where the Buddha attained enlightenment. So for practitioners, this is a very sacred place to meditate, to pray, and there's so many blessings that are here.
Ook veel leken zijn soms na gevaarlijke lange tochten van heinde en verre naar dit pelgrimsoord gekomen.
We're here for 10 days, and this is the 15th year of the Monlam Chenmo, the World Peace Ceremony.
De World Peace Ceremony gaat gepaard met het uitdelen van duizenden boeddhistische boeken. Deze zijn vanuit Californië naar hier verscheept. De laatste vrachtwagen is de vorige avond aangekomen.
There are about 25 trucks that contain 200,000 of books. Everything went really well. We got the books through customs and things went very smoothly. So if you can imagine that, it's like 25 train containers. I think it's possibly the largest distribution of Buddhist texts so far.
Sirpu, sirpu, sirpu.
Our father is Tartong Tulku, and he's a Tibetan Nyingma Lama. And he was born in Tibet and educated in Tibet. He was of that generation of lamas before the occupation of Tibet who had the good fortune of receiving a really comprehensive traditional Dharma education. So many monasteries and libraries were being systematically destroyed in Tibet. So over 1300 years of the sacred Dharma was just being wiped away. And I think at that time in his life that sense of purpose and a dream was born for him, that it would be his life's mission to try to preserve the Buddha Dharma of Tibet by preserving these sacred texts. My father made it to Berkeley, California by 69, and he started a small Dharma center there. And for over 30 years now, this is what he's been doing, and each year it continues to grow on a monumental exponential scale.
Our community is really guided by a very strong presence from my father, where, you know, just for example, right before the production of the books that were being offered this year, we were given a goal that not one single person, even after 30 years of having worked with our father, said, you know, this is going to be possible. No one thought it was possible.
A sense of urgency, a sense that we can't waste 1 minute. This is his basic mantra to all of his students, is that time is so precious, a human life is so precious, and it's up to us, once we recognize something that is of value, that we not waste our time, we not waste our energy and our potential and our strengths, and, you know, to just do it, to just cut through your weaknesses, your confusion, and your limitations. Work becomes a vehicle for accumulating merit, for purifying obscurations, for awakening. So work itself is spiritual work.
There is a selfless quality that comes through, and it's really deep and real, because people are working 12 to 14, 16 hours sometimes, 6 days a week, and they're putting their whole energy and body and mind into it.
For me, as a daughter, as just a human being, to see that kind of potential in a human being is really extraordinary. It's one, very humbling, and two, it's very inspirational to see that we have in every human being that possibility to put so much energy out.
In 1989, Rinpoche went to India for the first time in 30 years, and he invited a number of his Lama friends to join him at Bodh Gaya for a month of ceremonies. And he prepared some texts that first year. It was a very small number, a few hundred texts, but people requested him to repeat the ceremony, and it became an annual ceremony. And after that first year, he started producing more texts, and the second year we sent enough so that we could still take them on the airplane as excess baggage. But by the third year we had to ship them, and then it began to increase in scope all the time, and soon we were shipping containers of books, and this year it's going to be almost 200,000 volumes that we're shipping to give away. One of the reasons that we put so much effort into doing it now and why there's a kind of sense of urgency is that there is a turning point in Tibetan civilization coming up. The last generation of teachers who were completely trained in Tibet, who understood, who knew in their hearts and their bones what it meant to be raised in a culture that was dedicated to the Dharma, that generation of teachers is passing away. And they are the ones who can really transmit the essence of these teachings to their students so that it will continue from one generation to the next. So we feel as though it's tremendously important to get the books in the hands of the teachers now, not 5 years from now, not once everybody has computers and can look at them on screen, but right now.
Jang Dolma komt van een nonnenklooster uit Zuid-India en is al voor het derde jaar in Bodh Gaya. Ze heeft ervoor gekozen haar leven aan de Dharma, de leer van de Boeddha, te wijden. Yam Jiang heeft haar Tibetaanse ouders, die in New York wonen, al 7 jaar niet gezien.
We're on our way to the main temple site, where we're going to start pre-positioning the Prajnaparamita books that will be given out to about 150 tulkus and kempos. So right now we're going to meet with the book distribution team, and it's just rain, so we're hoping that all will go well for the rest of the day.
Reciteren en nog eens reciteren is wat Yam Jiang hier samen met 7000 monniken en nonnen dagenlang doet. Hoe daarmee de wereldvrede bevorderd wordt, zal later belicht worden.
This side we have only 100, and this side we have 25, and this side we have 45, and after Nan's place we have 4.
It's raining. We're going to be moving to the Nyingma Monastery. So right now they're taking a break, and then they'll continue at the Nyingma Monastery. So the offering will probably take place tomorrow morning. So that's what's happening. Do you think that if we put instead of getting the pallets, you don't think the plastic would be good enough?
I don't think that'll do any good, really.
Really?
Yeah, I think we have to get them up off the ground.
Off the ground completely?
Yeah.
Okay. Pema? We need to organize getting monks to help us to get the pallets. Basically, we're going to have to move the books and put pallets down because it could rain more.
Son-in-law, we need to get 100 monks, if possible, to move the books up onto these pallets.
Right now?
Huh?
You're talking about right now, right?
Yeah.
I think they already went. I think it's really difficult.
Yeah. We just go to the gate right now and we ask the monks to help us.
Yeah, this would be good.
And we need to get Mark, because Mark and Arno, we'll get the monks. We're getting the monks now, but we need somebody to kind of lead them of what they need to do.
Voor het eerst in 15 jaar World Peace Ceremony regent het in Bulgarije. Vannacht worden Boeddha's boeken met veel zorg droog gehouden. Nog even geduld voordat de teksten hier aan de andere kant van de wereld het daglicht zullen zien.
The Nyingma Monastery, where many of the books have been actually stored and unloaded. And there was a convoy of 25 trucks, 25 containers worth of books, which is what we see all around us covered with the tarp. It's considered very auspicious and meritorious to actually make the distribution, so all of our effort is going as much as possible to have the books given at the tree. It is deeply symbolic that the Dharma is being returned to the place of enlightenment. We hope that that kind of effort is something that will last for a long time.
Nadat Boeddha ruim 2500 jaar geleden onder deze boom lange tijd gemediteerd had, doorzag hij het leed in de wereld. Ook leerde hij hoe dit leed te verlichten.
Er zijn nu geloof ik 750 teksten zijn hier nu over de laatste 15 jaar uitgedeeld. Dat is maar een heel klein druppeltje. Maar de belangrijkste teksten, daar is je natuurlijk als een gek mee bezig om die, zolang dat nog kan, om dat te doen. Al die Tibetanen die gevlucht zijn uit Tibet, die zitten in India, Nepal, Sikkim, Bhutan. Al die kloosters zijn zich daar weer gaan vestigen. Ik denk gauw een paar duizend. Die hebben nu een dak boven hun hoofd, ze hebben eten, hè, dus sinds 1960, dus dat is al 25 jaar. Maar wat ze niet hebben is bibliotheek. Nou, wat Tartan Tuku voor ogen heeft, is om die bibliotheken op te bouwen. Dus de Prajnaparamita, die hier wordt uitgereikt, die is in zijn geheel niet voorhanden. En dat heeft hij dus dit jaar gedaan. En het zijn dus 7 dozen die bij elkaar die ene groep van teksten. En die gaat over hoe je in het dagelijks leven het boeddhisme kan beoefenen. En wat is daarvoor je uiteindelijke inzicht eigenlijk voor nodig? Hè? Dus het inzicht en je handelen, daar gaat het allemaal over.
Today we will be offering the Prajnaparamita text. We'll also be offering various tankas to the General Assembly for all of the monks and nuns that are there.
Aandachtig worden voorbereidingen getroffen om de hoofdlama's die rond de 4 windrichtingen van de stupa zitten, ceremonieel de boeken aan te kunnen bieden. Beno Rinpoche is straks de eerste. Hij heeft de hoogste senioriteit en zit aan de westkant van het monument, direct voor de Bodhiboom.
The Prajnaparamita is a sutra. These are teachings of the Buddha, and they are the highest teachings of enlightened knowledge. The Prajnaparamita is about the nature of emptiness. When you ask me what is the meaning of emptiness, I can honestly say that I have no idea, but I would certainly like to gain insight into that. And that is basically the project of Buddhism, is ultimately to gain direct insight into the nature of emptiness.
I feel very genuinely that it is a choice that you have to come and grow into, and the value of it becomes more beneficial and real when you understand your life and you really understand, you know, the truth of suffering, and you go through life experiences really, you know, what is the reason why we study the Dharma. It's not only from a traditional cultural standpoint, it has real practical benefits into your daily life.
Dharma is the teaching of the Lord Buddha. So Lord Buddha himself said, in near future, I will come as a book. So people should respect, people should try to read, try to practice what's written in there. So the book is just like Buddha himself. I think the main thing is, how do you say, transform oneself, change our mind, attitude and all that. This is our main goal. So there are lots of different methods to do that. By doing prostration, you see many people doing prostration. It's not an exercise, but it's kind of a method, because you do visualize in front of you, Buddha and the books and Dharma and the Sangha, everything you visualize in front of you. And then yourself in the middle, surrounded by especially your enemies, your father, your mother, all sentient beings doing prostration together. So this is all kind of part of training. So same thing, when we are chanting, we are not just saying words. So maybe some younger, junior monks, maybe they are not really concentrating. But most of the senior monks and those who know how to do it properly. So it's sort of developing positive mind. The negative thoughts and the positive thoughts, it's like a light and dark, cannot be together. So if you can create more positive light or positive thoughts, automatically your negative thoughts and the darkness will reduce. So when you don't have the darkness or the negative thoughts at all, ultimate light, that is enlightenment.
Het onophoudelijk reciteren begint zijn vruchten af te werpen. De waarneming wordt gezuiverd, ook al begrijp je als leek de teksten niet direct. Op een onbenoembare manier heeft het een helende werking. Helend omdat alles één lijkt te worden. Het ik lost op.
Before practicing, we have to learn it. So that's why we are learning. Without learning, if we practice, it's like without hand and climbing the rock.
Yam Jiang is vastbesloten om evenals haar leraar Peno Rinpoche ook lama te worden. Ze moet daarvoor 3 jaar, 3 maanden en 3 dagen in eenzame afzondering leven om zich volledig aan meditatie en studie te kunnen wijden. Na zo'n intensieve retraite gaat Yam Jiang ervan uit dat ze meer kan bijdragen aan de vermindering van het leed in de wereld.
After becoming lama, we believe that we gain more power to destroy the obstacles and defilements. Solutions. So if we become lama, we can help the human beings in every way. I want to practice on and on till my death.
This is the Guru Rinpoche, and then one of the greatest Nyingma master. And actually, he was born in India, like we call it origin Yuji. Like so, he brought all the Vajrayana to the Tibet. So all the Nyingma Pas, they call him Second Buddha.
Als je het maximale van je geest naar voren wil roepen, dan roep je op Padmasambhava. Dus Padmasambhava is een historisch figuur. Maar als ik visualiseer en ik ben daar zo mee bezig, dan roep ik in mijzelf op. In boeddhisme geloof je niet in een kracht buiten jezelf. Alles wat buiten jezelf is, is een reflectie van wat je in jezelf hebt. Dus als je je geest, als je dit in je achterhoofd houdt, zou je volgens zeggen, als je dit in je achterhoofd houdt, dan wordt dit langzamerhand wordt dit onderdeel van je geest.
van binnen zijn we niet gefixeerd. Niks is vast. Alles is continu in een state of unfolding. Hè? En daar hebben ze een term voor en het is sunyata. Die term wordt vaak vertaald met niets of ledigheid. Dat wat er nu is, bouwt het volgende. En wat er nu is, komt voort uit het vorige. En die stroming, die continuïteit zonder begin en einde, dat is één van de waarheden. En dat betekent dus dat je, ja, dat er veel verdriet is, omdat je vasthoudt aan dingen die al niet meer zo zijn. En vooral in relaties is het natuurlijk vaak zo. Je begint heel enthousiast en voor je het weet zit alles vast. En als je denkt dat dat fixed is, als dat gefixeerd is, ja, dan kan je ook niet veranderen. Maar in principe in een relatie of op werk kan je elk moment opnieuw beginnen. Maar het is je zelfbeeld. Ja, nou, dat doe ik niet, dat kan niet, dat wil ik niet. Hè. Maar je kan elk moment kan je het beter maken, omdat de waarheid is dat de situatie in principe open is. Er is niks dat vast ligt, dat jou zegt, je moet zo zijn.
Geestelijk voedsel genoeg, maar ook de boeddhistische maag moet gevuld worden. De staf zorgt dat er ook gekookt wordt voor 2000 bedelaars die vanuit de omgeving komen, omdat ze weten dat er tijdens het festival wat te halen valt. Men verzoekt hier vriendelijk om deze vaak aan lepra leidende zwervers te ontzien door niet onnodig de camera op hen te richten.
Here we are. This is one of the texts that we offer to the assembly. One of the questions that I'm often asked by both pilgrims and many people since Tartong Rinpoche was the founder of the Nyingma Monlam Chenmo, why he's not here. Since we began an exponential increase in actual text production, he's there as the primary proofreader and oversees all of the production. And so as much as he would like to be here, his priority now is to work on the books and work on the preservation.
We have this 32 monasteries that they're supposed to be sending us representatives, and we give them their sets.
We periodically call our father every couple of days. We also send back faxes during the ceremony, and we get further instructions about how we can do a better outreach to the different monasteries. He helps give us guidance about how to get an understanding of how, you know, what are called the mother monasteries and the branch monasteries can all receive some of the precious texts that we are distributing now.
So, Parnell, these representatives come. There's this list that you're familiar with.
Only 10 days, limited time, you know, 7,000 people. We try to give as much as possible, but we have to look at our priorities in terms of where the books should go, and we hope to send them out to the far remote areas of the Himalayas.
Thank you.
Milam jaga duri dan landu ami changma milam yore ra digap so ngandi molam ya ha ko sunna pole thak thagrung bone eni jema ngandi la yong sung tini molam so ya ko ka yong sung ka su theng tang bo yong sung ngani sem te kha kha re sem tang theng tang bo chirang di duri dan la yong gi ka te sem ka ka ye
I'm going to go to the house.
I pursued a master's degree in international politics because I really wanted to get involved with doing some political activist work for Tibet. And what I really wanted to do was to be a part of saving Tibet's unique cultural identity. And I realized that this opportunity was right in front of me with the work that is being done here in this community. I realized the kind of enormity of what we're doing here. It actually happened to me yesterday at the registration table of all places, right as I was looking out at the temple, at the stupa. Just some feeling of the blessing of the books that we're offering and the realization of how lucky I am to be able to have a part in this transaction of the highest wisdom that will ever be available to humankind. And when that kind of dawned on me, that this is, you know, slipping through my fingers, I felt my heart open tremendously, and I felt the wish that to really study these texts deeply and not just be a purveyor.
Mm-hmm. So now the monks are on the queue to get the text, and afterwards we will get the text.
No, deep down, we're not going to learn. It's just deep down, it's not. Deep down, it's not. That, deep, people who talk to you, when you're talking to them, Ramuchegi te par gyawa chasan ngazul ta chik lobing namba ge chene thone chasan pimisi chasan kora radio te kar kar che yene Ramuchegi jema chasan kare na de ngazul lama tawa chasan la chasan radio ta lo pechin lo goods do ro ngadelle ni che chasan ras je chasan ras
She's my teacher, and she taught me in my fourth standard. Her name is Ngal Panjur, and she's from Tibet. Now it's the third part and the third path of Buddhism. It's called Ujung. Ujung means the light. It's like, for example, it's like delusions. The delusions are like firewood, and the wisdom is like a fire. And the fire burns the wood in this, like this. The wisdom burns our delusions and defilements. The main writer of this book text is Kunkin Longchen Ramjam, and he's also a Bodhisattva. And he's the Nyingma sect's greatest scholar. All the people in this world, they are rounding, circulating in this world again and again, dying and burning, because of this defilement and delusions. So if we can practice this text, and we can destroy the delusions and defilement, and we can stop burning in this world. In in Tibetan, the topics, this book is called Semnin also. Soul rest.
These 10 days, my job is very good. Two types of job. I'm feeding beggars. We have minimum 1,000 beggars. And I'm helping this offering 100,000 butter limes every day. There's 15 kilos butter and we need 130 tins. So we have monks and nuns and who are helping us for. We have 140. So that butter lime is very important. In order to purify our disturbing emotion, we have to cultivate good karma. How can we cultivate the good karma? There's a few ways to do. One, your offerings. Second, is practice, meditation, or chanting. We have a lot of grasping, attachment, grasping, my, I. In order to abandon those things, we need to offer something.
Janang janakaya madhye sante na soma vidina jitava munindo
tante. If you want to learn Buddhism, you practice, learn philosophy. Philosophy gives you confidence. And meditation gives you experience. These are the great two wins.
And they sleep at day and walks in night. And it took almost 1 month by foot from Tibet to Nepal.
Yamjang helpt bij het vertalen. Sommige Tibetanen willen niet in beeld komen omdat ze ook ver van huis de Chinese bezetter vrezen.
It was quite dangerous for them. They risked their life.
Ik heb het gevoel dat ik het gevoel heb 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 dat ik het
ตาเจลอกดังตะนี้ตะกะกังกะเจงเกะเปคันนึงมาชิงจองตะฮาโกดึงหาโกดเตะกะตะนี้ตางะซอลอกเกนดิติเลกะเชมิตาเตเรนจึงชื่อเวกะดะซาตากวาตานะนโรงะมังะมาชิงจองเตนโรโหตะตาตาโลจุซึนซะรีซองเตลันะตากวาริชินะนะยงโก
Mantra of Jambalyang Mantra, Manjushri, the God of Wisdom. This prayer will in this his mantras are printed and rolled here, so we have to circulate it. We can't open. Kasi jumara. Kasi jumara.
Kasi is somebody. Kasi jumara. Kasi na yung jumara. Kada maje jumara.
The mantra is
it is ra ka majera it is tam
we ko nang tun nai du ha chen te ra
nang ta tun ta ri mare la tu
you will get sin demerit will be a demerit for us are ro la ge ma go ye de 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 ra ye ta ye ta ha ta ye ye ta wa ra ye ne ra ge ye ye ma go
তো কলতে তামো তাতার মচে না নাঙ্গু দি তিনকেন সং কল ও মারি কল নাঙ্গু চনে গাসু চে তাতে নে পেচা মাংবং দো পেয়ং চেন বং দো চেন ফুয়া গোম দো সং লামান দে সং চনে তা নেপাল নে দি সাং দি নিউ দং তনে কলতে ইয়ো দি তা লো মাংবো রি তে ইয়ো নে তে চোকে চসো টুপা নি নাওয়া নে ইয়ো দি দম্বা কো ইয়ো দম্বা নে ইয়ো তনে নিয়াং কাং কাসে কম কম ইয়ো লেকা ওদনে নিয়াং ইয়ো নিয়াং কা মজে নে নিয়াং
I offer the Dharma Bell with the deepest love and respect to my parents, my venerable teachers, my fellow countrymen, and the people of Arya Desa. I dedicate it to the world peace, the longevity of the Dharma, the memory of Tibet civilization and its destruction, and to the 100 million who perished in the violence of the last century. Tartang Rinpoche, Khunga Gelek, Yeshe Dorje, the head lama of the Tibetan Nyingma Meditation Center, born in 1935 in Golok, Eastern Tibet.
How to make from a tragic situation something that's miraculous, an offering, how to transform personal tragedy into practice. I think when we talk about the secret of my father's kind of success, it really lies fundamentally in his love of the Dharma. He's somebody who did have a traditional education in Tibet, so he knows what was lost.
Here we get a two set, please. Two set, yeah.
Okay.
Maybe you would look at all of these books and think that the money is sort of coming from some generous donor or some generous foundation, but in fact,
resources are very tight, and you're always constantly having to sort of what he calls
struggle
and juggling. And you know, you just that's one of his favorite terms. You're struggling and juggling, and you know, you take a little bit of money from, you know, possibly the sale of some books here, and then you put that into the cost of the paper, or you try to get really good deals with, you know, the paper companies and invite them to the showroom to show what's happening, so that they could also see that this is not for commercial purposes, that this is actually in fact being distributed for free. The students that he's working with, and they quietly for the last, you know, 30 years or so, have been working just day and night, especially when the time comes to go into production mode. There is literally a 24-hour shift going along.
We come here for 10 days, and we have the great honor of representing their hard work. And those people behind the scenes are the real, you know, heroes behind the work. Hello.
There's so much work to be done. I mean, every day back in Berkeley and here, there's always, you know, a list that's 500 times larger than what you think you can do. And because the list is so big, you actually have to let go of yourself. You know, I'm Tsering, I can only do this amount. In a way, when you're given an opportunity to do something that's just beyond your own idea, you naturally come into something that's bigger than yourself. I think that's what my father creates.
De dagen voegen zich aaneen. Het lijkt wel of er onophoudelijk boeken uitgedeeld worden. Uren en uren staan de pelgrims in de rij. De tijd telt haast niet meer.
Offerings.
Yeah.
Yeah. So then after that we can.
5 o'clock.
The
money offering.
That's a new assembly.
800 monks at 5 o'clock.
Really?
No.
Oh God.
At 100 monks.
Thank you.
En wat nu met de wereldvrede? Hoe klinkt het chanten vanuit dit oord door op plaatsen waar de nood het hoogste is? Ook 2500 jaar geleden heerste er al ongelijkheid en vredeonderdrukking. Welk antwoord had de Boeddha toen?
This is very powerful to be here and to walk in the footsteps of the Buddha and to see probably with our own eyes what the Buddha Shakyamuni saw himself in his own lifetime, all the kind of environment which was the basis for his own contemplations, for his own seeking of truth. And you know, we have to ask ourselves those same questions when we come here. Is, you know, how can we ignore the suffering of beings around us, especially when it's so direct, so in our face here in Bodh Gaya? And you know, it's like a wake-up call. Some people have an orientation to feeding, you know, feeding the hungry and clothing the poor and giving them shelter or educating them socially or politically, trying to empower them. But that's all important and essential for one's basic survival. But the Buddhist view is much more vast and transcendent. You know, we seek to remove the very causes of suffering, the roots of suffering. And the only way that we can achieve that aim from a Buddhist perspective is to awaken beings to their own Buddha nature, to give them the gift of wisdom, so that people can see what is ultimately liberating beyond just the here and now, beyond just our personal suffering.
Yang Jiang wil geen vergoeding voor haar hulp als tolk. Ook niet, wanneer we voorstellen dat ze met het geld een cadeautje kan kopen voor haar vader, die ze een week later voor het eerst in 7 jaar weer zal zien. Ze wil echt niets. Ze is blij dat ze iets heeft kunnen doen. En of we haar slaapzaal nog even willen zien.
DVD's bestellen van onze programma's? Bel 040 282 0022. Wilt u meer weten over onze uitzendingen? Vraag dan nu de gratis programmagids aan. Bel 035 629 3191 of kijk op www.boeddhistischeomroep.nl.